Yes, Twitch, I know that I'm streaming. You don't need to send me a notification that I'm streaming. I've got a pretty good handle on my own streaming situation, but thank you. Hi. Happy Monday. Happy January 22nd, Year of Our Lord, 2018. It's Polish Grandfather's Day today, so if you have a Polish grandfather, make sure you give him a call and wish him well, or just, call your grandfather anyway. If they're, if they're still with us, or take a moment to think about your grandfather if they were good, whether they were Polish or not, but especially if they were Polish. This is Lizard. This is a brand new Nintendo Entertainment System game. It's so brand new that it's not even technically out yet. This is the public beta, which you can opt into by purchasing the game in the URL in the stream description, lizardnes.com. I really hope you can hear me because somehow all of my settings for streaming audio versus recording audio got screwed up, and this is one that I want to record a commentary-free version just so there's one of those on YouTube because there's not a ton of footage of this game on YouTube yet. So, okay, cool. Jane of Philippab is here. Welcome, Jane. They say that they can hear me fine, so I will push start. I have played nothing of this game other than this screen, the screen over here to the left, and I went through this door because I needed to find a section of the game that has music for audio testing purposes, and that's all that I've seen. All I know about this game is that it's a platformer and it has some sort of exploration-y stuff going on, which you all know I dig. I found out about this game because Jim Stormdancer, the creator of Frog Fractions, was talking about it on the Video Games Hot Dog podcast, and it sounded like something that I might be into. He described the platforming as being a little squishy, a little not perfect. But we'll see. You can hold down and a direction to do this kind of slow walk. It's like I'm crawling, except I'm still standing up. This is a very strange looking lizard. I'm not sure about the appearance of my snout there. Hopefully we learn more about this lizard as we go. This game is by Brad Smith, who I assume is not the same Brad Smith who used to play bass for Blind Melon. And I assume this game also does not have anything to do with the webcomic Lizard. This is what I get when I push the start button. My lizard is the lizard of knowledge, and I get the password down there. And then if I go over here to the left, it has that number in there. So I guess at some point I can get more passwords and put them in here. And I could just start putting in random numbers and go through this door and see if it takes me anywhere, but I think I'll just play it the honest way. So we have a jump button, which is A, and then the B button is brings up this little interface that shows you sort of the directions you can go and probably other stuff I can interact with. And that's the start button. And the select button did that. Oh, is that like, oh, that must be like an instant retry. So there might be puzzles where you can get stuck. And you can press the select button to kind of reset the world. You can either download this as an NES ROM, which is what I'm playing right now, or you can download a standalone executable, which I guess is just an NES emulator. It looked like a custom thing. I didn't see any license information or anything, but it has some options like ignore the sprite limit and stuff that might make it play a little bit better than actual hardware, but the creator is planning to release this as a cartridge. Oh, here we go. Move, slow, up to enter, A to jump, B is lizard thing, select is hold to retry. Oh, so that's why select didn't do anything when I just pressed it. Well, I don't like that retry animation. I don't like seeing my own skeleton. And then start to pause. So we have this icon here letting us know that we cannot proceed. It says version 0 here, but on the title screen it said version like 5 point something. I guess that's the beta version. Okay, so this password, it looks like it resets. If I walk off the screen and come back, well, no, maybe. Wait, yeah, it did. Alright, so I guess we're going through this door. This is the door that I walk through, just to find a place with music. We have a head here, which seems to be some sort of checkpoint. When I do my lizard thing, it just points at it, pointing out that it's important, I suppose. And this is all of the game that I've seen, so it'll be 100% blind from here on out. Yeah, it is weird that it has a password system, and I figure if I do any saving, it'll probably be with save states. Oh, that's not a friendly panda. It looked like a friendly panda. Oh, stay away from me, lizard. And then you have to press the start button to proceed. Oh, but he only gives you one warning. Can I jump over it? Okay. Is water instant death? No. I mean, I am a lizard, so most lizards have, you know, some swimming capability. Build up quite a bit of momentum. Jumping seems okay so far. I don't know if I can access that coin or not, though. There might be some Metroidvania type aspects to this where I need upgrades to access other parts of the world, or maybe I'm just not jumping right. Benzene thinner oral alcohol lizard is built to precise specifications. Do not. That's not a friendly bird. Well, maybe I should take this panda's advice and try going the other way first. There's a coin down there. Okay, so I have a different password on the screen. Maybe there's a different password for every area, and I can just write down the password. I mean, maybe it's more like a fast travel system than an actual save. I like how you can jump back up to the title screen. That's pretty good. I figured that would not be a friendly friend. Can I jump on enemies, I wonder? Can I jump on this enemy? Nope. Okay. Yeah, I have no idea what to expect from this game. Honestly, I wasn't sure if there would even be enemies. Jim Storm Dancer kind of made it sound like more of a knit stories kind of exploration thing without much in the way of combat. Quote unquote. Aw, man. Movement does have some weird momentum to it. I guess that's why they give you the slow walk. Maybe I should start using it. I'm just going to check that screen periodically to see if I have any new messages. You know, check my lizard mail. It's a cute cat. It's too bad it's almost assuredly deadly. Oh, what did I press? Oh, I pressed a shoulder button. And so I started using the Steam controller utility to map all of my buttons to Xbox 360 buttons. It's like a built-in controller emulator, and it works really well for Steam games. But it also sort of takes over the rest of your computer. So it's a little weird. Like sometimes, oops, I probably shouldn't have done that. Oh, so it automatically changes this password to whatever the last password. Okay, so it's just the checkpoint. I see. Interesting. Yeah, sometimes I press a button and it will have some action and I don't know why. Like, I don't know why the right shoulder button would sort of make the window lose focus. The left shoulder button brings up my right-click menu, which is really weird. Got another checkpoint. That's progress. That's a very different password. The last one seemed to be sort of a small increment of the first password. This one is wildly different. Music seems really good in this so far. The developer of the game is also a pretty prominent chiptune artist. I don't know if he works in other media as well, but he definitely does a lot of chiptune stuff. USB classic controllers is what Jane of Philipab is looking out for. If you mean the Nintendo classic controller, I don't think they ever came in USB, but you can buy an adapter for it. What I'm using is the Hori Pokken Tournament DX controller, specifically made for the Switch. And it has a USB connector, so I can just plug it straight into my computer. And it is a very good classic-style controller. You know, no sticks, it has a simple D-pad, four face buttons, nice clicky shoulder buttons, and it has the plus minus ZL and ZR buttons on the face. Oh, you have a SNES controller for your computer? That's cool. I'm sure adapters for the SNES controller are plentiful. I don't know, I find that the D-pad on the SNES controller doesn't hold up as well as I would like. I mean, it's better than a lot of modern options, but I really like the feel of this Hori D-pad. Hori makes some fine products. I wish they would just let Hori make Joy-Cons. You know, custom Joy-Cons that you can buy so that they have an actual D-pad instead of the four face buttons or the four split buttons. And I know they do it like that so people can use the Joy-Cons in two-player games. Oh. Okay. Damn it, shoulder button. I'm just gonna close Steam while I play this. Because otherwise it's going to cause problems. Okay, good. So I press down here. Or no, I don't even have to press down, I just have to jump onto this platform. And there's some sort of human inside of me. Or humanoid, anyway. Whoa! Okay. So the red lizard has this sort of fire shield thing, but I no longer have the question mark ability. I don't know if interactable objects will still show up. I wasn't really using that ability anyway. Does it do anything else? Oh, my lizard is a lizard of heat. Okay, so that tells you which lizard you are currently controlling. Oh, but I can't just walk into an enemy. Okay, so the knowledge lizard sort of tells you stuff about the world. But there's not really a lot of stuff that this lizard knows about. I kind of want to explore with this lizard a little bit first and see if I can learn some more stuff about stuff. I want to see what that other slab said. The first slab I saw didn't really have any information. Those little frogs or jumping mice or whatever, they look like grass tufts. Like, it doesn't look like something that would actually be an enemy. Or dangerous to me, so I have to be careful. Remove it. There are other skins, and if I get too close, they wit. Okay, so same information, regardless of which side I observe it from. Okay, well, I don't know what the heat lizard actually does for me, but I will give it a try. So am I a person in a lizard suit? This is a very odd game, which I enjoy and appreciate. Because once I change lizard forms, it doesn't look like there's going to be an easy way to change back. Oh, there's an actual exit down there. Huh. Oh, I went the wrong way, I think. Oh. Maybe I have to be the heat lizard to go in the lava area. Oh, that's right. I have to go up this thing. Yeah, pressing down and then a direction to move isn't the most intuitive thing. To move slowly, I mean. I wonder if it remembers which coins I got. Nope, doesn't look like it. So when I die and I go back to a checkpoint, that completely undoes all of my progress, including stuff that I collected. That's kind of a shame. That's going to, well, so far I don't know what, if anything, the coins actually do, but if it turns out they're useful for something, then that's going to disincentivize me from exploring. I must have gone right from here to get to the fire lizard. No, because then I would have noticed that slab. Well, great. Well, at least I hit that checkpoint after I picked up that coin. So, hopefully that'll be saved now. I really want to find that fire lizard skin. Maybe get to a checkpoint with it. Or try to. Oh, did I go up here? Yeah, that's where I went. Okay. Oh, that looks like a jump I should be able to make. So I did find some additional knowledge with the Lizard of Knowledge that might help me out. I don't want to just jump into the lava. Well, I guess it won't take me that long to... Okay, so the fire lizard cannot just survive the lava. I don't know how I'm supposed to get down into that little lava crevice. Oh, yeah. That was a cat. Well, at least I confirmed that I do have that coin now. Should have checked to see if it changed my password at all when I picked it up. Well, I guess it wouldn't change the password until I get back to the checkpoint. Dang it. Wow, it took a lot longer for that reset thing to kick in that time than it did before. But yeah, I guess that's good. I don't want to accidentally press that button and reset when I don't mean to. Maybe if I hold down the fire shield button, I can well, I'm going to save first. If I can make it back to the save point. Because if I can hit the checkpoint, then I can just start experimenting. And see what the heat lizard is actually capable of. I mean, I could... Oh, am I going to, like... Is water going to be bad for me? Okay, good. Okay. Okay, so it's not bad for me, but I cannot activate whatever this does if I'm in the water. Alright, so even if I don't actually touch the enemy physically, the fire shield doesn't do much to them. It doesn't seem to do anything to them. Alright, so can I do this? I cannot. Can I... Okay, so it can at least take out these things. So I guess it's good at taking out smaller enemies, kind of like the boomerang in The Legend of Zelda. But now I do not have access to knowledge. I cannot read the tablet. But like the boomerang in Zelda could kill like the bats and the smaller versions of the slimes. Alright, so this crab, it doesn't hurt the crab, but it definitely doesn't like it. Well, whoa, I was not expecting to fall off into Tron World. Really like the glow effect. This looks very good for an NES game. Which it should. I mean, the developer has years of all of the graphical tricks to make the NES pump out as good looking graphics as possible. Or I'm sorry, graphics. I want to start trying to say that word correctly, since I know a lot of people get pretty upset when you pronounce it with the hard G. So yeah, pretty good graphics for an NES game. Okay. That panda doesn't like the heat lizard either, apparently. Well, at least I don't have a life limit. Ooh, computer. Oh. I've 36 bones? Wait. Huh. Well, at least I don't have to be the knowledge lizard to use the computer. So far, the only use I've found for the heat shield is killing small animals. Which I wish I didn't have to kill them, but when I turn into a skeleton... Oh, that must be what it means by bones. That's how many times I've died. So yeah, when a small animal instantly skeletonizes me, I guess it's kill or be killed. It also had a pretty accurate timer there. Accurate to like the millisecond. So the creator must be expecting people to want to speedrun this game. Oh. Okay, there's another good use for my heat shield. Is melting ice and collecting that coin. Oh, I killed a frog I didn't have to. That was a friendly frog. Well, clearly I need to get the lizard of jumping. Alright, that doesn't phase it. Seems like a very large world. Or it might only seem that way because there's no map. At least I don't think there's a map. Might be able... Oh, hey! Oh, man! Take that. Alright, that's a friendly frog. Okay, so this area... Oh. Oh, this is the new lizard. My lizard is the lizard of swim. Okay. So when I tap the lizard button when I'm underwater, it does the little water hop there. Okay, I'll switch to the lizard of swim for a little while. Maybe I should try to get back to where I was and go into that underwater area. Although at this point, I really don't know how to get back where I was. I fell a pretty good distance. And I don't think I can just use the password as a fast travel thing, because then, you know, I wouldn't keep the lizard form I'm in, and I wouldn't keep my coins. Which, I mean, who knows if the coins actually do anything. If they're just a pointless collectible, then I won't worry about it, but if I can buy, like, a map or a fast travel system... The screen transition really throws me off. Like, it looks like I should be able to just jump up there, but then the screen transitions and the thing is slightly higher than you think it should be. I have to sneeze, so hold on. Oh, sorry about that. I don't know if that thing up there on the right is something that will kill me or not. So far, there's not really a good system. Oh, I can just stand on this thing? See? That's what I'm saying. There's not a good system to tell what will or won't kill me. Yeah, I had too much momentum there, and I just fell farther than I intended to. You don't have a lot of air control when you jump. At least not the way you're used to. It does feel a little bit more like a Mario 1 in terms of the jump physics. Hey, you want to get out of my way? I would like to collect that coin, please. I will swim you away with my lizard swim. Dang it! Yeah, Yeah, I see what Jim was talking about in regards to the platforming. It definitely doesn't feel like games that you're used to. Or at least that I'm used to. I wonder if one of the lizards is a lizard of good jumping. I wonder if I could talk to these non-hostile creatures, if I was the lizard of knowledge. I hope at some point it gives me the ability to just switch between lizards without having to find a skin. I do appreciate the fact that I don't really have a goal other than figuring out what the world's all about. Exploring. I don't know why, but this looks like a trap. This could be a goal. Maybe I have to light all six of these sconces somehow and resurrect the lizard god. It seems like a thing that a video game might ask a lizard to do. If I have the lizard to swim, I probably shouldn't be going up. Map? Okay. Alright, so... So I'm in the pipe area. Is that little black dot in the middle of the pipe area up towards the top, is that me? Well, no, I'm still in the underground though. So it must be, I must be that little red dot, I think. Well, this map is less helpful than I was hoping it would be, but at least a map exists. It's just a shame that I have to come to this area every time I want to look at it. Okay, I should take another look at this map and try to tell if there are six distinct areas to match the six sconces. So you have underground, you have pipes, you have water, you have mountain, you have forest, and you have plains. So yeah, that could be what's going on here. Maybe I need to collect every coin in every area to light all of the sconces? Perhaps? I do like a game with a good mystery to it, but I have to say, I wish there was, one friendly character who doesn't talk in riddles. I mean, the big slabs aren't exactly characters, but you know what I mean. You know, I wish there was... I mean... The character doesn't even have to give me information, just something to, someone to talk to, some sort of friendly face or a friendly voice, because otherwise the game feels a little alienating. It's the same reason I didn't care much for the first Metroid, because Samus is just alone in this giant alien world, which, you know, is good. That's the whole point of it. And that feeling of isolation is really powerful, and that's why people were drawn to it. But just the fact that you don't have a single friendly voice in the entire game, you know, a friendly character, someone to relate to, someone to ground you. I mean, even the original Super Mario Brothers had Toad at the end of every castle, and I mean, he just said the same thing every time. He wasn't like a groundbreaking, you know, he wasn't like an important feature of the game, but you know, it was something. And then in Mario 3, you got the... Oh, OBS just disconnected, you know. Right on schedule. My internet connection has been fine. Then as soon as I try to stream, stuff just starts happening. But yeah, in Mario 3, you have the letters from the princess. And, you know, the Toad houses and the little Toad minigames, you know, they're people who are there to cheer you on and make you feel not so alone. And so far this game doesn't have anything. I guess we'll see though. Whee! Well, it's saying OBS reconnected, so if anyone is watching live, then hi. Sorry about the problems. This happens every time I stream. My internet goes down for like 10 seconds, and then it just immediately comes back. And I guess I should be grateful that it's not going down for longer. But it is slightly annoying. Like, I don't even need a character to give me a quest or anything, or to tell me why I'm here. Just a character to say hi. It's good to see you, Lizard. It's been a while. This jumping is starting to feel less good as time goes on. Or I guess I should say more bad. And I did have a warning about the jumping. You know, Jim Stormdancer did say that he found it troublesome. I like some unique jumping physics. If it feels a little bit different, but it just takes some time to get used to. But it's solid overall. But I don't think this is very solid. Alright, I need to get that coin again, which means I need to make these very exacting jumps over these enemies, and you know, good luck with that. This game does make me want to keep playing in spite of the controls though, just to see what's going on in this world. Can I just swim up there? Air is a fluid. I bet there's a lizard of flight. That would be so cool. I mean, those exist, right? They're lizards with sort of bat-like wings or bat-like appendages that can sort of, you know, if not fly, then they can at least glide, right? Aren't there lizard gliders? And, you know, who knows what time period this game takes place? Well, there's a computer, so I guess that rules out the age of the dinosaurs. But there could still be a pterodactyl. Why not? I'm not going after that coin. Maybe if the game gives me a reason why I want the coins, I'll go after them then. But so far, I don't have a lot to go on. I can't even see how many I have without accessing the computer. Oh, I bet I have to use this thing to jump off of, because I couldn't quite make this jump before. Can I direct this thing? Can I make it get closer to the edge here? Yeah, by myself, I'm just not able to make that jump. I guess I need the Wizard of Crab commands to do that. Oh, whew. Alright. I forgot that I have to press the other button to swim. I tried just pressing the jump button when I was underwater. That's not how you do it. God, I hate these screen transitions. I wonder if that was a design choice or that's a hardware limitation thing. I know that making a game scroll both ways on an NES is incredibly hard. That's why Mario 3 and Kirby's Adventure had all those weird little artifacts at the edges of the screen, because it allows, those games allow for both vertical and horizontal scrolling, which takes a lot of hackery. But it seems like you could have sections of the game that scroll vertically and sections that scroll horizontally. But I don't know, I'm just talking out of my ass. I know nothing about NES development. Okay. Other button to swim. Oh, this jellyfish is coming after me. Okay. I'm in my element. I'm the Lizard of Swim in the Land of Swim. Swimming feels okay once you press the right button. Oh, so those things down there are going to be like missiles that shoot out at me, right? I remember those. Lizard of Stone. Okay. So, my assumption and my hope is that I can, yep, just fall down there, turn to stone, and the missiles just bounce off me. Of course, I can't keep the Lizard of Stone because I'll sink like a stone. I like how all you need to convey underwaterness is a blue background and a little white circle that occasionally floats up. That's all you need. And ideally, different physics for being underwater, but it's not a requirement. Oh no. I do not care for these jellyfish at all. Also, I would really love another checkpoint. Hey, it's a dope fish. Nice. I would really like another checkpoint. Asking, you shall receive. So is this... Okay. I think this is somewhere I've been before. Yeah! This is the door that took me to that underwater section the first time. Okay. So if I go over here, that's going to be the Lizard of Knowledge, right? Because I traded the Lizard of Knowledge for the Lizard of Heat. And then the Lizard of Heat is wherever I got this lizard. Well, I guess I should explore some more of the underwaterness now that I got the checkpoint. Feeling a lot better about stuff. I guess that checkpoint I just hit is the closest thing I have to a hub area. Well, it's going to be a pain to get. I like how you can just sit here for a few minutes after you die and just watch the scenery. You don't have to immediately respawn. Should I keep trying for this coin? I mean, the coins might be the whole point of the game, you know? I don't know. Oh right, I need to get this one again too. Well, let's get that one since it's relatively easy. And then I can save again. I could start abusing save states since I am playing the ROM version. Actually, I don't know if the executable has save states or not. It has a menu where you can go in and change some options and stuff. I don't remember if it had like a save state option or not. Oh, there's a checkpoint over here that I missed. Oh, I think I remember this area too. Isn't this sort of close to where the map was? Or it's in the same general... Oh, right. Sure, that probably kills me. Why not? Yeah, the swimming actually feels extremely good. Which is why I'm sort of staying here. As opposed to going and exploring other stuff, because I like the empowerment of the swimming physics. What the heck is this? Some sort of square? Oh yeah! Sure, that instantly kills me, why not? Okay, so I can't touch the bubbles. Or the floor. Okay, so I can't touch those bubbles either. Well, I wasn't expecting a boss. I don't know how I even deal with a boss. I seem to have no attack vector, unless I can hop bop it on his head, which doesn't look like that's the case. It's at least it gives me a checkpoint right before the boss. That's very nice of them. So I can't touch these pink ones at all either. Okay. I just wanted to double check. Okay, so the octopus is going to grab one of those things. Wouldn't it be funny if the only way to beat this boss was by coming here as a lizard besides the swimming one? But that's not a jump I can actually make, so yeah, you have to be the lizard or swim for this boss. Unless there's another lizard who can also swim and can also shoot laser beams out of its eyes. Do I have to make it pop all of these? No? Do I just have to wait until its supply of... I don't know what these things are. Are these octopus eggs? Is it flinging its babies at me? Its unborn brethren? Or, not brethren, its unborn, progeny? I mean, even if you could come here as not the Wizard of Swim, you would just immediately die because all you could do is stand here. Alright, so my best guess, at least right now, is that this is just a survival challenge. I just have to survive until all of these baby octopi, or I'm sorry, all the baby octopodes are depleted. Then maybe the octopus will be so sad that it dies of sadness. It's like, why did I sacrifice all of my children to try to kill this lizard? Why do I care? The lizard didn't do anything to me. Ugh. That is a very good-looking octopus, though. I'll give it that. I remain impressed by this game's graphics. Patterns are becoming more unpredictable, which is good. You don't want it to just be the same boring pattern over and over again. Or maybe just I'm perceiving it that way because as the baby octopodes deplete, I'm getting more and more nervous. So it just seems more erratic. Like, I don't know what's going to happen when they're gone. I mean, I guess I can just sit here and watch what happens when they're all gone. No. Oh. Okay, well, I'll just jump through that portal. Oh, darn. Wait, did that... That didn't count. I felt like the portal was smaller that time. Like, I couldn't just press up and walk into it. I had to jump. Surely... That doesn't count as beating the boss. And then I can just refight it for leisure purposes. As a hobby. Yeah, mostly what I do is I just I just go underwater and fight octopuses. Octopari is the correct pluralization of octopus. Yeah, like before. Oh, never mind. I think it was just bobbing slightly too high for me to just walk into it. Well, at least I have confirmation that after all the babies are gone, I can just, if I can survive a couple more seconds, then the octopus just dies. I was right. It dies of sadness. And then I can just leave. I'm trying to think what this music reminds me of. Reminds me of something on the NES. Oh lord. I feel like the octopus is getting slightly smarter. Like it's actually dropping where I am. You know, this is not what I was led to believe an octopus's garden would be like. I was expecting a lot more shade, a lot more, drinks with little umbrellas in them. Oh, it doesn't take me back to where I was? Weird. Okay, can't go left. This is the first time I've seen a lizard that's actually, a fellow lizard that's not just skin. Oh. Whoa. There are people in lizard suits. This lizard adventure has reached an ending, but there is more written on the page. Okay. Lizard, a game by Brad Smith, 2018. With very, very special thanks to Molly Landgraf and all the rest. I'm not going to sit here and read out a list of names of people I don't know. Weird. So I wonder now, if I go back to where those sconces are, if one of them is going to be lit. Since I completed one of the lizard objectives. Of course, I don't know how I would even get back to check. This panda still doesn't like me. I mean, there's plenty of this game that I haven't explored, so I'm not done with it by any means, just because I reached one of the endings. Also, it didn't seem to care how many coins I had collected. Like, it didn't even give me a number at the end. So maybe at some point I do need to be the Lizard of Stone and just get out of there. Maybe there's a way I can exit by walking rather than swimming. Oh, that's a good place to put an enemy. Alright, screw you, Panda. Alright, screw you, Panda. Oh yeah, if I was the Lizard of Swine, I could get that, no problem. Boy. Screw you, Panda. Screw you, Panda. It's weird that you have to press start to advance that text. Hey, Aseb, welcome. Sa to you as well. Yeah, this is a cool game. I have a few problems with the way it controls. So far it's just been released as a ROM and executable, but once the beta test phase is over, the developer does plan to release a cartridge. And I really appreciate him putting the ROM out there first, because there was a game that was released a few years ago called Battle Kid, which was a new homebrew NES game that I would have played, except it was only available as a cartridge. And I'm definitely not buying a Nintendo Entertainment System and, you know, I guess presumably, well, I wouldn't need an NES, I would just need some sort of ROM dumping device. No, this is by a guy named Brad Smith. No, it's a public beta test. Anyone can get the ROM. You just go to the webpage in the description and pay $10. My lizard is the Lizard of Bounce. Okay. Oops. So there is a good jumping lizard. Oh, I don't know the Battle Kit guy's name. Oh my god. Wow. Okay, I take it back. There's not a good jumping lizard. There's whatever this thing is. Wow. But yeah, I don't know if there are Battle Kid ROMs out there yet or not, but I know that for a couple years after it came out, I scoured the internet. And, I mean, I would have paid the guy money to play his game if he had released it in a form that was playable. Oh. And I don't know how he avoided having a ROM release for his game. There's probably one out there by now, right? There would have to be. I mean, these days, all you need is a Retron, right? Can't the Retron dump ROM images for you? Oh, there were two Battle Kid games? I did not know that. And yeah, this was a while ago. A lot could have changed since then. But at least, you know, at least at first, I bet I can get that coin. At least at first, the game was only available as a cartridge. And it wasn't cheap either. It was like $50, which is a lot to pay for that kind of game. Oops. But I imagine if he wasn't releasing it on physical hardware. I mean, do a physical hardware release for people who want it, but, you know, the vast majority of people aren't going to be able to play your game. Yeah, I should check again. There has to be a ROM out there by now. These checkpoints don't give me information, do they? No. Okay. So yeah, kudos to Brad Smith for putting the ROM out there. Alright, so maybe I can get that with the Lizard of Bounce. Maybe that's why they put it there. The jumping, you don't have a ton of air control. It's not horrible. It's just not as precise as, say, a Mario 3. Like, it feels more like a Mario 1 to me. So, do you like Battle Kid, ASAP? I wasn't sure. You said you own the games. Oh, yeah. I tried that last time and it didn't work. I mean, I really like this bounce. It's goofy, but, you know, I was expecting, like, maybe a double jump. That would be cool. But this game likes to subvert your expectations. You have to be in the mood for the difficulty. Yeah, it looked like it was sort of inspired by I Want to Be the Guy and that whole wave of, like, the massive core games. Alright, so I could probably bounce up there, right? That tiny, insignificant mouse doesn't kill me. Did I swap a Trill symbiote to my lizard friend? No, I think they're just humans. Like, I beat one of these scenarios and I got a little cutscene. And it looks like they're just people in lizard suits. Although, the sprite doesn't look very human in the cutscene. Well, cutscene is a strong word. It was just a picture. But they had faces and they looked human. Alright, I'm going down here. So what happens if I take not the lizard to swim underwater? Like, maybe that's what the select button is for. If I just get stuck in a place where I can't get out, I can just instantly end it. I mean, I want to keep the lizard to bounce because it's new, but I don't know where to take him. Seems like no matter what happens, I'm going to run out of bounce steam eventually. Like, why does this tiny frog mouse creature kill me, but the green ones don't? Like, it's a total mystery. Maybe I need to be the Lizard of Heat here, but, you know, God knows where that one is relative to where I am now. Are the tiles 8x8? I'm not sure. I'm not really observant enough to be able to tell. Oh, so if I... Huh. I can sort of press the jump button while I'm in the bounce animation. And that sort of... Well, I guess that's just... Just a normal jump. Just in the middle of the animation. Okay, well, at least I made it back to the checkpoint. Oh! That just kills me. When I was the Lizard of Knowledge, it said, you know, just go that way. I guess I need to be the Lizard of Swim? Although that doesn't look like the kind of water I could swim in. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I might just have to give up on the bounce lizard. One moment. Sorry about that. I had to cough and take a drink. Alright, well, let's see if... Wait, this is just the knowledge lizard, right? Well, this isn't going to help. Unless I can figure out the knowledge to jumping over these tiny mouse frogs. Well, I mean, it got out of my way. Maybe they respect knowledge. So I have... Yeah, this whole icy area up here. Yeah, I was gonna go back to that waterfall. But I forgot that I was knowledge and not water. Yeah, these penguins don't want to talk. God, look at all these tiny frog mice. I hate it. Oh yeah. Yeah, this is definitely telling me that I need to be flamey right now. Which makes sense for the ice area. Okay, so where should I go? Oh yeah, I shouldn't go on top of the bird. Yeah, when I was the knowledge lizard, if you just hold the button, you just put on your bouncing boots. Okay, I thought maybe I could like bounce across the water if I just held B. Because I wasn't really holding it before. Alright. Now the question is the frog mouse going to get out of my way again? Okay. Okay. So it's like it looks like if I get really close to it, it gets kind of scared away. But it also starts bouncing back towards me if it can't find a better way to go. So I gotta be a little careful. Nope. Don't think I can bounce my way over to that one. Panda don't care. It feels like I'm getting more height on some of these jumps somehow. But I don't know what, if anything, I'm doing differently. So at this point, I'm starting to suspect that there is no transform into whatever lizard you want button or upgrade or anything. I don't think it's that kind of game. So there has to be a way out of here because it gives me an underwater checkpoint. Unless this is just something that the designer overlooked. But yeah, if it gives me a checkpoint, then there has to be a way out no matter which lizard I am, right? One would hope, anyway. Yeah, my bounce is completely useless underwater. Oh yeah, that's right. Okay. Yeah, I forgot there was a door right there at the bottom of the sea. Yeah, it does do some pretty good horizontal scrolling, although the vertical scrolling, it doesn't scroll, it's vertically, it's from screen to screen, but the transitions are not the best. Like, a lot of times when I'm going vertically, I try to, I try to jump onto a platform, and by the time the screen changes, the platform is in a slightly different position, and I can't make it. But, small quibbles. And the bounce lizard, I should probably try to get somewhere really high and jump off, and see where I can bounce to, right? It seems like something a bounce lizard would like to do. Oh, I bet I can bounce up and get that. Or not. But yeah, the horizontal scrolling is very smooth and nice. Yeah, I can definitely see why someone working with NES hardware would prefer to do single screen rooms. Not as bad as Kid Kool, yeah. I haven't played that one. So here you can see what I'm talking about. Like, it looks like I should just be able to jump right onto this platform, but then the screen transitions and I end up falling. But, you just hold jump a little bit more. And so far I haven't died because of that. It's just been an annoyance. With platforming that's already a little weird, it doesn't help matters, but it hasn't been a game breaker. That looks like a jump I should be able to make. Yeah. Oh yeah, I remember this. I just fell off back into the continue room. I can't imagine what circumstance I would use that room in. Oh boy. I suppose it would be if I was actually playing on a physical cartridge and I needed to turn off the machine, then that room would be the only way to save and continue my progress. Alright, do I actually get, an extreme amount of bounce? No. Okay, so there is a limit to how high I can bounce. You get a slow drag the screen scroll transition vertically. Oh, kind of like the Legend of Zelda screen transition, where it sort of scrolls slowly from one room to the next. Yeah, that would be really bad if you're trying to make a vertical platform jump. What are you doing here, crab? This isn't a crab habitat. Or a crabitat, as I like to call it. Yeah, the few games on the NES that had smooth scrolling both horizontally and vertically, it was basically sorcery. Like Mario 3 and Kirby's Adventure. And I'm sure there are others, but those are the two that sprang to mind. They are hacking the hell out of that system to be able to do that. And it's just something that we super take for granted today. Oh, I don't know anything about like the technical details, ASAB. I'm not really a hardware person or a programming person. I just know that, you know, some things were extremely difficult to do with certain hardware. All right, so I should probably be the fire lizard and go back to the ice domain. That seems like the best, like the most obvious thing I can do right now to make progress. Yeah, I do know that some games actually had, you know, chips soldered onto the actual cartridge board itself to enable more, you know, give you more hardware to work with. Oh, one of the MMC3 chips made diagonal scrolling much easier. Yeah, that could definitely be the case. Okay. I wonder if it would even be possible to release a physical cartridge that takes advantage of some of those specialized chips today. Like, I wonder if it's possible to get those chips or to manufacture a new one. I do know, I was reading a little bit about the Nintendo reproduction cartridge market, because I saw a guy on eBay who was selling a bunch of bootleg Super Nintendo games. Like, he was selling Chrono Trigger and Earthbound for like $10, and he had a bunch of negative reviews, but he also had a bunch of positive ones, and he's been doing it for like a year, and I was wondering what his process was, how he was making a profit off of it, and like how he was getting away with it. And like the chips that they use, you know, they don't make them anymore. The chips that they put the actual game on, like they just take the shell of you know, a sports game that there's a billion of that you can get at a thrift store for like 50 cents, and they solder these ROM chips onto the board, and they are, you know, they're limited in quantity. Like, there's going to be a point at which those reproduction cartridges aren't going to be possible to make anymore, unless someone starts actually manufacturing the chips, which that seems like outside of the scope of, you know, what someone who's not affiliated with a giant company would be able to do. You know, you wouldn't be able to commission like a factory in Shenzhen to start manufacturing these chips unless you were just ordering in massive quantities, and there's not the demand for that kind of thing. Yeah, I mean, they can farm the chips from existing cartridges, but, you know, eventually those are going to run out too. I mean, I guess there are like 10 million copies of Mario 3 out there, so it's not like that specific chip is going to be rare. I do not understand what would make someone want to buy a reproduction cartridge of an actual game that exists and they can just buy the cartridge of. Like, and the eBay seller I was talking about, he wasn't or he or she was not disclosing the fact that they were reproductions. They were selling them as if they were the original game, although, you know, someone selling Chrono Trigger for $10, it's obvious that it's not the real thing. But there are people who actually want to buy these reproduction cartridges, and I just don't understand the market for that. Like, either you're a game collector and you want to own the actual thing, or you just want to play the game, at which point you just download a ROM of it and play it on an emulator. Like, I don't understand this middle ground. Yeah, I mean, if the original card is prohibitively expensive and for some reason you want to... I hate these crabs so much. Oh, that's right, I have to use my heat shield to make them jump. Like, if you just want to play the game, just download a ROM. Like, but, you know, I've never been a purist about that stuff anyway. I guess someone might want the authentic experience of playing Chrono Trigger on an actual Super Nintendo, but doesn't want to pay whatever cartridge costs now. So, I guess that's a use case for it. But... I don't know. Like, having the authentic hardware experience has never been important to me. You know, Chrono Trigger is just as good in an emulator as it is on the hardware. And a lot of these reproductions, they say, you know, like, saving only works if you play on a Retron. But then, a Retron is just... it's just dumping the ROM and emulating it. So it's like a billion extra steps to just emulate it. Yeah, exactly. Or you can buy, I haven't heard of the Power Pack, but you could buy an EverDrive. I have an EverDrive for my Game Boy Advance, and it's great. I put a 64 gig micro SD card in there, and I can play every Game Boy Advance, Game Boy Color, Sega Master System, Game Gear game ever made. And that thing costs, like, you know, the price of two reproduction carts. Right, I need to go back underwater. I want to get back to Ice Domain. I'm very out of my element, being the heat lizard underwater, but... preserve their save games. Yeah, but then you have the original cartridge, presumably from when you were a kid or a teenager or whatever, and you can buy something that lets you dump it to save your save game. I understand that, but I just don't get buying a new copy or a reproduction copy of a game that exists. But, I mean, I guess, you know, let people indulge their hobbies however they want. Right, yeah, exactly. They already have the battery back cart. And that is important because those batteries don't last forever. So, yeah, if you have an old cart with an old save that you want to hold on to, you need to... you need to either get in there and replace the battery, or buy something that lets you dump the save. Yeah, I mean, if you're buying bootleg games in the first place, then clearly you don't have a moral problem with, you know... or you shouldn't have a moral problem with downloading a ROM or buying a flash cart, so... I don't know. I mean, I don't get game collecting either. Like, I'm not a person who is going to pay $100 for a video game I can download and pay for free... download and play for free. You know, if I pay someone $100 for a copy of Chrono Trigger, or You know, it might be more now. I don't know. I mean, complete unbox is probably like thousands of dollars, right? But, you know, if I pay someone $100 for just a bare cartridge copy of Chrono Trigger, it's not like the developers of the game are getting any of that money, or, you know, it's not, you know, I don't think it's something anyone should have a problem with morally. This place sucks. Who designed this place? Oh boy. Yeah, that's the other thing. I'm broke, so. Holy crap. 650 NES games? That's like very close to a complete US. Well, I don't actually know. I mean, I'm sure there aren't more than 100 NES games that are actually worth playing. But yeah, that was a very impressive collection, but I'm glad you were able to offload it to someone and get some use out of it. Oh, 100 short of full NES. Yeah, that's what I thought. Like, I thought there were only like 600 or 700 US NES games. Which seems like a low number, now that I think of it. Boy, my plan to go back to the ice area really panned out, huh? Yeah, I am definitely not going to get every lizard that I need and bring them back to the areas where I can use their abilities to get all the coins. That is not a thing that I am interested at all in spending time on. Maybe eventually someone will do a 100% run and get all the coins and post a video on YouTube, and I'll probably watch that, but it's not. Okay, so that's the first instance of the vertical scroll actually causing a death. Lizard percent. Yeah, it hasn't given me any indication of how many coins there are, whether they actually do anything, or whether getting the coins matters in any way, so I'm not going to worry too much about it. I don't think it told me how many coins there were. When I looked at the computer, it said how many coins I had, but it didn't give me a percentage or, you know. At the time, I only had the one coin, but it didn't say one out of, you know, however many. So, who knows? There could be a million. They could be just randomly generated for every playthrough of the game. You know, who knows? Nah, the coins were definitely placed deliberately. I can tell that much. That was a bad idea, but I did it anyway. Because I'm a boss. Oh, look at that. Now I fall on something that kills me. No? Wow. I just got two coins basically for free. Alright, didn't I get to the ice area? Like, wasn't the ice area on the other side of the underwater area? Oh, right. I don't have fire. I'm underwater. What am I thinking? Like, I feel like... the ice area was... just this way and through another door, and then I had a little bit more walking to do after that, right? Or do I have to go up and right? Because I did fall down to where that checkpoint is. Yeah, underwater fire. That's something they did in SpongeBob a lot that I found amusing. I don't know what Bubble Guppies is. I'm sorry, Aseb. But in SpongeBob, they would, like, camp out underwater and, like, have a roaring fire going. And then pour water on it to put it out. So, just a real confusing mess of water logistics. But, you know, it had a blue background and there were bubbles, so you definitely knew they were underwater. You know, the two things you need. Yeah, there's definitely an arrow there at some point. Bubble Guppy is a kid's show where the protagonists are merpeople. And they have fires and snow, etc., all underwater. Well, I have never heard of that. Is it modern? Is it something from a bygone era? Because, okay, so there were the Snorks, which were like the underwater version of Smurfs, but that was a little bit before my time. I think that show technically ended while I was still alive, but I was like, you know, 2 or 3, and I might have watched it at some point, but I don't remember. It's like 3D Snorks. Interesting. So I'm starting to think it won't be possible to get back to the ice area from here, but I don't know which direction I would need to go to get there. Would be nice if I could just pull up a map. Oh, you were born in 77? Yeah, I was 85, so... you know, Smurfs... I did watch the Smurfs at some point. That was a show that was on in syndication while I was old enough to remember it. But, yeah, I don't think I ever watched the Snorks. God, I can't believe the Smurfs were rebooted as, like, sassy 3D animated cartoon movies. Like, of all the things they can dredge up from the 80s, why the Smurfs? Yeah. I'd rather have, like, a Masters of the Universe reboot. Which I'm sure has either been done or is in the works. Oh, maybe this is the underwater part I need to go into. And then head right. A lot of these areas don't have enough distinguishing features. Yeah, this is the same place I just was, wasn't it? Isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, it's very important for an exploration platformer to have details that separate one area from another. And I guess this one technically does. It has these big stone slabs, but you can only read them when you have one specific lizard, so it's not like I know which slab is which. Oh, they put Smurfs in the human world? I mean, there were humans in the original cartoon, weren't there? Like, there was at least one. You know, Gargamel. I mean, he was like a wizard. It wasn't like our modern-day Earth. Which, I guess that's what you're talking about. They put the Smurfs in our world. Yeah, Gargamel. Wait, Pee-wee? Was there a Smurfs Pee-wee Herman crossover that I was unaware of? Or is that a different Pee-wee? That would be a really weird combination. Although it does make sort of sense. Was there an explanation for why the Smurfs were in present-day Earth? I mean, I guess they don't need one. No one who's going to go see the Smurfs 3D cares about the rich Smurfs lore. Okay, so it was a non-Herman Pee-wee. Okay, that's good enough. Oh, they go through a portal to our world, of course. Which lizard was this? Is this Bounce? I think blue is Bounce, right? Yeah, I came all the way back here to get the heat lizard. So I could go back to where I kept dying to those little kangaroo rat thingies, and I can't figure out how to get back there. Yeah, at this point, I don't know if there's a property from my childhood that I would actually want anyone to reboot. I mean, most of the stuff from when I was a kid that is good is still around, you know, stuff like Mario and Zelda. You know, they just never went away. Let's see, what, like, I'm trying to think of stuff I have fond memories of experiencing as a kid. Like, I'm not a very nostalgic person in general. Like, I'm nostalgic for video games, but none of the shows I watched back then are stuff that I would actually go back to, for the most part. I mean, there was a Ren and Stimpy reboot, that was god-awful. Apparently there's going to be, like, a Rocko's Modern Life revival, and, like, the production art I saw actually looks pretty good, but I think it's just going to be, like, a one-off episode thing. Okay, so it seems like it's hinting that this is the way I want to go with the fire lizard. So I guess to get back to the ice world, I need to go back through this whole electronic world. And I need to not die to this panda. Yeah, most stuff from when I was a kid, I am perfectly content to just let it be. Because I know that even if someone did reboot it, it would probably not be very good. Hey, computer. Yeah, I have 12 coins. Out of how many? Who knows? I do like that the computer is called a Lazari. That's pretty good. I wish I could play some games on it or something. Play whatever the lizard equivalent of Pong is. I guess the lizard equivalent of Pong is just dodging those beach ball things. Can I stand on these penguins? Is this deer going to kill me if I touch it? Oh, that's not a deer. That's like a hyena. Whoa! Oh my god. Oh, these enemies are getting pretty rough. Oh, okay, so if I don't touch it with the flame shield, I'm just gonna die anyway. Okay, good to know. I can't just have the flame shield up. I have to touch the little tiny insignificant critter. Oh, I can stand on the panda's head. Okay, that changes everything. I just have to make sure it doesn't smack me. It does count my total time played, though, on the computer, which is interesting. So, all that stuff where I, you know, where I completed one of the stories, you know, it didn't totally reset the stage of the world. Which I guess I could have determined that by the password, right? I do like how if you mess up and fall somewhere, you can usually just roll with it. Like, yeah, wherever I end up, there's probably going to be something for me to do there. Oh, I don't like these owls. Oh god, I'm back in fire dog hell. I like this section because it reminds me of VVVVVV. Any part of a video game that reminds me of VVVVVV is going to be good. I knew where I was. I tried to slow myself down, but just the momentum. It's a killer. Yeah, VVVVVV was cool because it didn't shove a lot of story in your face, and yet it was still there. Like, you have friends in that game, and you have, you know, it's not just a barren, mysterious wasteland. But it didn't, like, oversaturate you with story dumps or dialogue or anything. You know, it gives you just enough. One of the more perfect video games. Man, I should play some VVVVVV. Nah, I already have a full playthrough of that on my channel. I wouldn't accomplish anything by playing it again. Okay, so I can jump on the penguins. It sure looked like I could, but... I could fire up VVVVVV and try to do some of the Gravitron challenges. That would be more pleasant than... Okay, I don't intend to be mean to this game, but I'm not having a lot of fun playing it. I like it, you know? There's more to games than just being fun. It has charm. Has a lot of qualities I like, but in terms of enjoying the things that, you know, the actions that I'm performing, I'm not having a great time. Maybe once I can start killing these little mice things with impunity, I'll start having a better time. There's a lizard platform there. Or it looked like a lizard platform. Where was that? Right, it was on this side. No, I tried to hold it right there and didn't.
Oh.
Didn't have enough horizontality. Shit, mouse. Oh god. Why do you have some sort of terrifying wizard here? Wasn't there enough already to be afraid of without a terrifying bridge wizard? I don't know why I expected to bounce off of that penguin. And I'm just going for it. Like, since I reached that checkpoint again, I'm a lot, you know, a lot more open to being bold. That's one thing that would improve this game immensely, is more checkpoints. You know, just have a checkpoint on every screen, why not? If the wizard said, "I shall not pass," they didn't do a very good job of not letting me pass. I mean, they look very scary. Yeah, you do have a lot of sections in this game where it's just, you know, one screen to the next. But I'm sure that, you know, that's just hardware limitations. Did the world just wrap around? I don't know how I ended up back in that area. But yeah, I'm sure the developer would make the entire game scroll seamlessly if he could. Like, I thought I made it past the area with the panda and hit another checkpoint. Or maybe, no, okay, yeah, so, it was, okay, I know what I did wrong. Another thing that would improve this game immensely would be a map that I can access from anywhere. You know, like exploration platformers often have. Or even just like a little mini map in the corner of the screen. It seems like something that should be possible with what we know about NES technology now. Might have had to make some compromises to pull it off, but I think it would have been a very valuable addition to this game. You know, knowing where I am in relation to where I want to be. And I'm not saying every game, this needs a map. I cast one of the darkness, I think, pulled off a world that was easily navigable without always having a map. I think it did a very good job of it. Yeah, a subscreen with a map would be cool. I mean, it could just be even, the map that it gives you. Just a picture of the world and a little dot to show me where in the world I am would be a tremendous help. Yeah, pause screen, start screen, whatever. Maybe I need to find the Wizard of Map. I do like the premise of having, different suits with different abilities. But having to physically travel all the way to where one of those suits is just to access it. I probably shouldn't have hit that checkpoint, should I? Fuck off, frogs. I don't care about the good ones anymore. There is no good frog. If the green frogs were good, they would stop the blue frogs from destroying me. So they're just as complicit. All frogs are bastards. Only good frog is a dead frog. I don't know what this thing is. Can I kill it? It doesn't look like a frog. Maybe a subspecies of frog. No, it's just a little friendly thing. I mean, I could just take a screenshot of the map and use that as a reference. It wouldn't tell me where I am, but I could at least try to figure out what part of, the world I'm in general. Although it didn't show me enough detail to really be that helpful. You get to live, frog. I've decided. How come the computer doesn't show me how many frogs I've murdered? That's an important statistic. I got that coin at some point. Okay, so the thing I called the mountain earlier is actually that's the ice area. So I need to make it to the surface, which is pretty doable from where I am, right? Yeah, Recto, maybe not the best choice of a name for anything. Sorry, frogs. Good animation on those birds. That's several frames of animation. More than is strictly necessary. I'm just gonna hold this button down the entire time, so if I happen to bump into one of the deadly frogs, I'll be ready for it. And if a few innocent frogs die in the process, then, you know, you can't make an omelet without breaking a few eggs. Oh, okay, so you can stand on them, but they get mad, which is understandable. Yep, it is snowing, which is a good time to have fire ability. I press pause like that would bring up the map. I wonder if this cloud is like one of those solid clouds that they have in video games sometimes. I would only be able to get to it with the Lizard of Bounce. Yeah, this is that place. Eat shit, frogs. And for all that work, going back and getting the heat lizard and finding my way back, what do I get for it? A coin. That's it. This area doesn't continue, it just dead ends and then I fall into the water. Well, there are a lot of bad frogs down here as well, so this is also a good place to have Mr. Heat. So the boss for the fire lizard has to be in the ice area, right? All signs are pointing to, you know, this is where I want to be with this character. You know, there are frogs that I can kill. There was one ice block I can melt. There could theoretically be more. Another hyena. I like the hyenas. They're fast and hard to dodge. Yay, checkpoint! I just instantly feel a million times better. Now imagine if there were 10 times as many checkpoints. You'd have that feeling 10 times as often. Wouldn't that be grand? And yeah, I know I could just be save stating on every screen, but you know, I kind of want to experience the game the way it's intended to be played first. Okay, so this is a section I've been to, but it's a new part of it. Oh well. I might work my way back there eventually, I might not. Oh, it's just right here. Wait. That's the stop sign that it had on the tutorial screen, or the instruction screen, where I couldn't proceed any further. Oh, is this like a dangerous experimental lizard? The lizard of push. Oh, so it's just giving me an example of an object that can be pushed. Okay, so it is persistent across screens. Unless there just happens to be another one right here. Oh, so that's how I get that. Okay, good. Not push this any further. I wonder, maybe once this enemy rolls up into a ball, I wonder if it can be pushed. I'm probably going to kill myself trying to find out. Yeah, that's another thing. The one-hit kills, it just really discourages experimentation. Like, the knowledge that at any point I could, you know, any death sends me back, and I just lose so much progress that I don't want to try anything. Like, is this lava in the background, or is this lava that will kill me if I try to jump into it? Okay. It's lava that kills me. Okay, good to know. And now all of this is reset. I have to get this coin. I mean, it's not that far, but, you know. Also, I want to try melting this ice. Okay, so that's just another way to get up there. Having that be, like, the stop icon is also slightly confusing. Oh, I was hoping I could just write it down. That would have been fun. Or maybe it's the color. Like, maybe since I'm the pink lizard, I can push pink objects. So maybe that little caterpillar roly-poly thing counts. But again, do I want to risk dying and having to redo I mean, it's not that much work, but when you have to do it over and over again, it just gets tedious, and it makes you not want to experiment. Yeah, it wasn't rolled into a ball long enough for me to actually try it. I wonder if the public beta at this point is just looking for bugs, or if it's, like, you know, feedback about general game design and, you know, criticism of the mechanics and everything. Like, I wonder if Brad Smith is going to watch this video. You know, he could be watching this very stream, who knows? Just staying quiet. You know, I don't want to be mean, I like this game. And I like a lot of stuff that went into the design, but it feels like it it takes a lot of lessons from old Nintendo games that it shouldn't. Like, it takes some of the wrong lessons just about gating your progress and discouraging experimentation and just trying to increase the length of the game artificially by just, you know, having unfair difficulty. And I mean, I like a difficult game. You know, I finished I Want to Be the Guy. I play a lot of those kind of Massocore games, you know, like Super Meat Boy and stuff. But those games, they don't punish you. You know. That hard for failure. I mean, there are modes you can play that are like Iron Man modes. In some of them, in I Want to Be the Guy, there's, you know, a mode with no saves where you just have to beat the whole thing in one go. And, you know, for absolutely bonkers people who actually enjoy that kind of thing, you know, let them, you know, have the mode in there. But For me, and probably for a lot of people who would be into this kind of thing, it just takes a little bit too much from that old Nintendo hard mentality. You know, rather than being like, and I'm not talking about like technical stuff, like technically. You know, I was complaining about the vertical scrolling and everything. I have no idea, you know, to what extent that can be fixed with the platforms. But just the design, you know, how infrequent the checkpoints are, how, you know, not giving the player a map, not letting the player, you know, fast travel back to a save point or something, forcing the player to walk all the way to where another lizard platform is if they want to change to another lizard. And just the layout of everything, it's just very, very unfriendly. And, you know, maybe that's your vision, and that's the game that you want to make, and that's the game that you're going to make, and, you know, that's totally fine. But, at least in its current form, I just don't think it's for me, and I don't think it's something I can recommend to people. Hey, Fluffy Critter, yeah, this game is cute. It is charming in a lot of ways. There's a lot that I like about it. I just wish it wasn't so hostile to the player. Yeah, exactly, Asub. And, you know, part of that was just, you know, early video game design. They didn't necessarily know better ways to do things. Some of it was just trying to artificially, you know, pad out the length of their game by just making players do the same things over and over again and repeat patterns and, you know, memorize things. And that's not bad either. I mean, I like a lot of games like that too. Like, just look at Downwell. I mean, that's a lot of repetition, a lot of, you know, getting down muscle memory. And Cuphead, perfect example. You know, it's hard but fair. It's not, you know, if I lose to a boss, I don't have to fight my way through, you know, an annoying platformer level every single time to get back to the boss. I can just start fighting the boss again. Yeah, and yeah, that's another thing. Exactly. They didn't have enough regular people testing the game. And again, that could be the point of this whole public beta. Is the developer is hopefully watching videos like this and getting some feedback about it. I think my main feedback would just be way more checkpoints. Because if I didn't have to worry about just losing, you know, going 10 minutes between checkpoints means not only do I have to be careful, I have to be just, you know, cautious to a fault. Because if I make one tiny little mistake, boom, that's 10 minutes of progress. Oh, Cuphead is fair, Fluffy. I mean, I'm bad at video games, and I finished Cuphead. The bosses, you know, they have the same patterns. You know, they're not going to spring anything new on you. And they are, you know, the patterns are very learnable. And the default difficulty, anyway. Yeah, the expert difficulty is not fair, but I felt like the default difficulty had a really good curve. Yeah, you have to memorize the patterns, but it's not like, and you know, if you're not into that kind of thing, then that's fine, but like every time I died to a Cuphead boss, it was, I didn't feel like it was discouraging. I was like, oh, so close, you know, I almost had them. Wait, that door just takes me to the last checkpoint? I mean, I guess that makes sense. That's the continue door. I kind of thought there would be a door back. I don't know why I thought that. This game has a bit of Legacy of the Wizard feel to it. It's definitely as inscrutable as that game. Like, it presents a very strange world with not much information that you sort of have to puzzle out for yourself. Okay, so I'm back here. Back at the title screen. You know, if I had the bounce lizard, I could just bounce my way up here. I mean, there has to be something over there, right? Too bad I can't just switch to the bounce lizard. You know, too bad I can't push this block out of the way a little bit so I can jump up there. Yeah, Legacy of the Wizard, that's one of those games I like watching. Because it's just... like, it has kind of a weird friendly feel to it, which is weird to say because it's not really a friendly game at all, but... I don't know, like, something about the design feels very friendly. Like, visual design, not game design. Great. I don't know where I'm going with the push lizard. Like, I don't know where... you know, I don't know what has a thing that needs to be pushed. I haven't actually seen anything I could push except that initial block. Oh, right. It's this whole underground area. So I just got rid of the fire lizard. I ended up bringing the fire lizard back to Ice Mountain. And the only thing I got out of it was a coin. I mean, I guess I could have kept going up. And, like, now if I want to be the fire lizard in this section again, I just have to walk all the way back to where I left the fire suit and pick it up again. Like, that's more than should be expected of the player. Oh yeah, I wonder what the manual for Legacy of the Wizard looks like. A lot of times... the English manuals... oh, right. Not the Fire Lizard. The English manuals for those games were written by people who didn't necessarily have a lot of good information about the game. And they were just sort of, like, winging it. Or, like, they had, like, a Japanese document that was sort of translated that they couldn't really parse that well. And that's why I ended up with weird translation errors, like, in the manual for... I think it was Sonic 1. Like, the manual hinted about some weird secret that's not actually a thing or not actually possible just because of a mistranslation. Which one is... oh, this is Bounce, right? Well, now I can go back to the start area if I want to and see if I can bounce over that block. And then if there's nothing there, I'll be extremely disappointed. Oh yeah, Birdo was called Ostro. I don't remember if it was the manual, but I know that in the end of Mario 2, where it has the names of all the enemies, Birdo was named Ostro. And, you know, I can see the confusion because there is an enemy that looks like an ostrich, which, you know, that's what should actually be called ostrich. But, like, they probably looked at Birdo and, like, why? This thing isn't a bird. There must be some mistake, you know? They probably meant to call the bird enemy Birdo. And Ostro is just whatever this thing is. And then the manual for Mario 3 mentioned the anchor, which is clearly something that's, you know, it's meant to be a very obscure secret that most people won't ever find. And the fact that they mentioned it in the manual, despite, you know, people not figuring out how to actually get it for years, that was a source of frustration for a lot of people, me included. Well, my solid cloud theory was correct, at least. Why didn't I bounce higher? Well, I was going to try to go back to the title screen and see if I can get past the instructions screen. But now I kind of want to bounce on the clouds. I mean, you can say that about this game, at least. It makes me want to explore, which is good. It's frustrating that it doesn't make it easier to explore or encourage exploring. You know, the fact that stuff is there is very fascinating. It's just, I don't know. Maybe I'm being too hard on it. But I just don't feel like I'm having a great time overall. No, the only map in this game is a location that you can go to that has like a map printed on the wall. And I don't think it even tells you where you are. But yeah, I know that implementing an auto map isn't just, you know, not something you can just snap your fingers and do. So I wouldn't ask the developer to just, oh hey, just put in an auto map. You know, I know it's not that easy. But after more checkpoints, that would probably be my second biggest recommendation. Is some sort of, I mean, it doesn't have to be an auto map. Just let me look at that map without having to go to that room physically, and put a little dot on there showing which part of the world I'm in. You know, even that would be more than I have. Yeah, and I don't want to make assumptions because I don't know what sort of limitations the developer is working with. And I know that making a game for, you know, old hardware like the NES, it's, you know, you're going to have to make compromises. And I don't know how much RAM the developer has to work with, how much is taken up by, you know, sprite data or whatever, but yeah, just some sort of map. Like, I assume that more checkpoints would be pretty trivial to add. So I feel okay asking for that. But just, you know, when I look at the screen, just have the map there with a little dot. Yeah, that would be very helpful too. Map the exits I've been to. You know, why is this frog suddenly all up in my grill? It wasn't before. Before, they were just kind of jumping away from me when I got close to them. Now they're suddenly on the attack. Maybe they just jump randomly and I was getting lucky before. But yeah, I'm having a lot of the same complaints with this game that I was having with Silver Grapple. At least the areas are more unique. It's easier to tell where I am, but not by much. Yeah, all very reasonable things, Fluffy Critter. For an exploration game, anyway. You know, the kind of stuff that you would expect from a modern game. I mean, if it was just a platformer, then, you know, I wouldn't be worried about it. Yeah, the map could just be, you know, a background texture, basically, that shows up when, or, you know, background tiles. Well, that's great. I have to get all the way back there now. I don't know why I said all up in my grill. That's not the sort of thing I usually say. I was just very flustered. Ah. See, this seems like a good place to, you know, if you have a limited number of screens where you can implement smooth scrolling, this would be one of the ones, you know, that transition between mountains and cloud. That would be a good place to implement it. Because, you know, this jump would be pretty trivial if I didn't have to do it from an adjacent screen. I don't even know if there's anything else up here. I already got a coin. Like, if I had a map that maybe showed me that there are tiles up there that I can still explore, and I know I'm not wasting my time, might feel a little bit better about it. Oh my god. Wait. In the darkness, you hear a voice within your mind. I made the touchstones to protect us from our mistakes, but do not rely solely on their power. That is a mistake of its own. Is there some other path you have not yet taken? Maybe there is another way. Okay. Well, that was definitely new. I guess I died enough times that it decided to give me some more information. Well, I mean, there are plenty of paths that I haven't explored. You know, maybe you should make it easier for me to explore them. Instead of making me, you know, travel, you know, for 30 minutes to get the lizard that can go in a certain area, maybe just let me swap between them, you know? Once I find a lizard that can swim, just make switching to that lizard an option. And that way, when I get to a section where I can swim, I can say, hey, I can just explore this. I don't need to, you know, backtrack for half an hour, you know, dying multiple times along the way. Alright, I didn't actually get that coin because I ended up dying. This would be an ideal place for a checkpoint. IMHO. Yep. Ask and I shall receive, I guess. This might actually be bounceable if I take the right angle at it. No. I don't know what determines how much height I get out of the bounce. Oh, pretty close. See, what I felt like that wasn't as high of a bounce, when theoretically it should have been higher because I was hitting a lower, you know, section of the terrain. These birds aren't helping at all. Okay, so I think my problem was, like, I was subconsciously holding the jump button, and that messes up your bounce momentum when you do that. Yeah, that was almost guaranteed to happen, wasn't it? So yeah, as long as I bounce from a high location and, you know, it's like how you shouldn't keep one foot on the gas and one foot on the brakes. Like, I just need to move my thumb away from the jump button entirely so I don't accidentally press it in mid-bounce. Oh, come on, that bird didn't touch me. Do I even want the coin? Badly enough to keep trying this? Probably not, but, you know, I got it once. You know, that would be another thing I might recommend is, don't make me have to get the coin again when I die. You know, that's something that all modern games of this sort have learned, is don't make the player get the collectible again after they get it, you know? Ugh, this fucking panda. Yeah, exactly. You could just have a variable, basically, that you know, if you've been there, then it's a 1. If you haven't been there, it's a 0. And then just make a grid that corresponds to those variables, you know, at the very least. You know, it wouldn't have to be exact or anything. Just give me some vague idea of what I have and haven't seen. Would be extremely helpful. See, I was trying to go back and save, so I wouldn't have to get the coin again if I died. I haven't decided if it's time to start abusing save states yet. I mean, on the one hand, I would be a lot less frustrated, but, you know, if I was using save states and just loading my state every time I died, I never would have seen that message for getting that number of deaths. Maybe there are more messages if I die more. Bouncing all the way to the coin from up on the mountain. Yeah, I could. I mean, I would have to I mean, I don't think it would save me that much time or anything. Yeah, I mean, I got it. If I die, then I will have lost it, because I haven't saved again yet. Yeah, it's not getting the coin that's the problem, really. It's just, you know, saving my progress once I do. Maybe I should just try to jump over the panda again. Or maybe I should just not worry about the coin. Alright. Ultimatum. If I don't make it past the panda this time, I'm not going to worry about that coin. Okay. Okay, so now I can just worry about exploring the clouds. Yeah, that's what I was trying when the panda punched my lights out. I wish I knew why the panda didn't like me. I would think that lizards and pandas should be pretty neutral about each other. They're not competing for territory or anything like that, you know? Pandas, they're herbivorous, so it's not like they're going to be eating the lizards. Aw man, there goes my internet connection again. Shit. Okay, well it says my connection's back. Maybe it didn't actually interrupt it that much. Hopefully you're still watching me and you don't have to reconnect. My internet connection is slightly unstable at the moment. Oh yeah, Fluffy knows their stuff. They've been doing this kind of thing for a long time. As both a hobbyist and a professional. I mean, you're smarter than me, A-Sub, at least as far as old NES programming goes. Like, you know what all the chips are and stuff. Okay, we're back, says A-Sub. Good. Yeah, my connection is slightly unstable, so apologies for the hiccups. The recording on YouTube, you know, the video archive will be uninterrupted, but yeah, I really need to just get, I know I say this every stream, but I need to get a longer Ethernet cable and just bite the bullet and just stretch it all the way from my computer to the router. Because right now I'm on sort of a hybrid solution, like my computer is connected physically to a router that's serving as a wireless bridge. Now why can't I make this bounce? Have I tried Powerline Ethernet? No. I always assumed that would be extremely expensive and difficult to set up. I mean, what I have now is way better than what I had before when I was just trying to hit the wireless route or hit the router, you know, from my room to where the router is, which, you know, there's several walls between us and it was not a very good time. It's an off-the-shelf box that I plug into an outlet, and it has an Ethernet jack in it. Or on it. Oh, really? I don't have to do any, like, wiring or anything? How is the... Like, does it affect the connection quality at all? Wow. That's a lot easier than I thought. I will certainly look into that. To a gigabit, wow. Is it affected by, like, power fluctuations and stuff? Because we do have those from time to time. Not, like, full blackouts, but we, like, the lights will flicker for a second. I mean, it'll be way better connection-wise than what I have right now. I just want to make sure that wouldn't, like, damage anything. Oh, okay. I mean, I guess it's all just copper wire, right? It's just how you use it. It's pretty reliable. Okay. Yeah, I will definitely look into that. It'll be way better than having a 200-foot Ethernet cable strung across my house. Like, again, I would feel so much more confident about this jump if I didn't have to do the screen transition. Okay. Like, I don't want to give up and go somewhere else because I still haven't really accomplished anything. Like, I am no closer to finishing one of these runs than I was after I finished the Water Lizards run. Like, I've gotten coins, but what does that do? Surge protectors with Ethernet ports in them. Oh, yeah, that's probably just... I mean, most surge protectors are snake oil, to be honest. Yeah, that's for people who think that they need to filter their internet connection from the cosmic rays or whatever. You know, when tinfoil's not good enough. Oh, I should keep this jump going. I shouldn't land here. Yeah, that is absolutely what I'm going to do. Okay, so if I just keep holding B, I should have enough momentum to actually make that jump. From out the clouds. $600 megabits for $40. Well, that's way more megabits than I need. So the $40 thing that has both of... So what do I do exactly? Do I just plug one of them in near the router, run an Ethernet cable into it, and then plug the other one in near where my computer is? It has both endpoints. Okay, awesome. So what happens if, like, you live in an apartment building where people share, you know, share circuits, and they're on, you know, you have multiple people on the same electrical grid? I figure it almost never happens, but if two people are using that, it might get a little wonky, I would think. Then they can share their internet. Well, I mean that's true. But if they both have different internet connections, I would think that it would, like, they would interfere with each other or something. But I mean, they could just say, "Hey, have some of my internet, friend. I have more than I need." Right. I was going to take my time, but... Alright, I need to remember that I get more than a couple bounces. As long as I'm just holding the B button and I don't press the A button, I get several bounces out of one jump. At least from that height. So, I did not need to just book it the way I did. Man, that's cool. I didn't know it was that easy. I'm having some serious Silver Grapple flashbacks with this game. Just trying to execute the same physical action perfectly over and over again. God, that game was such a disappointment. Like, with the grappling hook physics, it could have been so much more than what it was. Like, I had no idea it would just be a series of, you know, perfect momentum challenges. Like, I thought there would be a little bit more exploration, but it's not that kind of grappling hook. Oh, wow. I'm not having a good time. I mean, I'm having a good time hanging out with Fluffy Critter and Asub. Thank you both so much for watching. I would be a little more frustrated if I didn't have people hanging out and talking. So I appreciate it. Oh, thanks, Asub. I love doing the Apple II stuff. I feel like not as many people are interested in it, so glad someone out there is. I need to go back to Adventure to Atlantis, speaking of obtuse, indecipherable games. I actually read the manual for that game, and it gave me some pretty solid advice. I would like to take another shot at that and see if I can maybe actually complete a run. Oh, you actually found me by my YouTube videos. Cool. Yeah, it's been very inconsistent with the Apple II stuff. Like, my first Apple II video was years ago, and then I did two more this year. Yep, Number Munchers, Oregon Trail, all-time classics. Did you know there were older versions of Oregon Trail? Like, older than the one that we all played on the Apple II? Like, this is something they've been talking a little bit about on Giant Bomb. Like, the original game was, like, early 70s. It was, like, 72. And it was just called Oregon. Shit. And it was a lot more text-based and a lot more simplistic. Yeah, and there were two sort of offshoots, or two versions of that one for the Apple II. And then there was the, you know, relatively fancy one that most people played in school. Like, the original game was like, it was like one of those mainframe games that you had to, like, connect to a server to play. Like, they only had it on college campuses and stuff. Also, it was a lot more racially insensitive. You know, a lot more murder of Native Americans. Which, I mean, I guess that makes it more accurate to what life was actually like back then. You know, as far as the murder and the genocide goes, but it's not exactly something that you want, you know, young students, you know, you don't want a class full of students being excited about killing Indians, even if it did really happen. I think the only mention of Native Americans at all in the famous version of Oregon Trail is like the guy that you can hire to get your wagon across a river. Like, I think that's the only time, like, it even mentions Native Americans. Which, I guess that's... Well, I mean, you know... I'm torn about a game like that. You know, how realistic you want to be as far as the portrayal of colonialism. Because it's important to educate kids and other people about that stuff. But do you want them doing that in a computer game, is the question. Yeah, the pepperoni and cheese version. Like, it's crazy. Like, everyone who's ever played Oregon Trail, their copy originated from, you know, who knows who, but someone had a copy of the game where they wrote pepperoni and cheese on a tombstone. And no one actually has, like, an original, you know, untainted copy of the game. So that's the only version that's out there, is the pepperoni and cheese version. And there's a project dedicated to getting cleaner versions of those games on archive.org. It's called the 4AM Project. Where people are trying to find original copies of games and stripping away, like, the crack screens and the, you know, the dial this BBS for more hot wares, all of that stuff. Yeah, like, I mean, when I was a kid, and, like, it's weird to think about, because my memory of that time is, you know, this was 25 years ago, it's very hazy, but I thought that the version of Oregon Trail I played at school was an actual, you know, non-pirated copy. Like, I seem to remember there being a label, you know, a nice printed label that says MECC and Oregon Trail, and but that version had pepperoni and cheese, so... It had to have been a pirated copy. I mean, unless the developers snuck that into the game and never told anyone. Yeah, I would think schools would have the legit ones, but apparently mine didn't. I don't know how much longer I can do this. Oh, your school had legit ones, so... Yeah, they are... I mean, there's gotta be a legit copy out there somewhere that just no one's bothered dumping. Because the pepperoni and cheese version is good enough. You are the president of the future, and robots listen to boomboxes too loud. I think I missed that one in my curriculum, Aseb. I don't think I took that elective, whatever that was. But no, we had Oregon Trail, we had Number Munchers and Word Munchers. I was always more of a Word Munchers fan. Because, you know, doing math in my head, no matter how easy it is not an enjoyable activity to me. But yeah, there was Odell Lake, like the weird fish simulator thing. Where basically just trial and error and a little bit of common sense. You know, what fish eat what other fish? What fish scare away what other fish? Can't actually bounce up there. The four, Mount Everest, Mount Rushmore. Yeah, apparently I blanked too because I was about to say Mount Everest. Oh, it was an internal for fuck's sake. I'm mostly able to play video games without yelling, even when I get very frustrated. If I get to the point where I feel like yelling, that's usually a good sign that it's just time to turn it off. But yeah, I'm not happy right now. I'm not having a good time. I don't feel like celebrating. Okay, never mind. This was all for something. This would be an excellent time to provide a checkpoint. Oh god, the owls. Okay. Ghosts that appear out of nowhere and are very fast. Well, at least their spawn and position is sort of random, so maybe I can avoid them. Yeah, like if I don't get a checkpoint soon, I'm going to probably have an anxiety attack and, you know, maybe lose consciousness. I hope there's a doctor in the audience or at least someone prepared to call 911. All right, everyone. This has been Lizard. Available for $10 on itch.io for the Nintendo Entertainment System. This is beta test version 4.1.9.0. Thank you all for watching. I don't know if I'll play any more of this. I might, if people found this entertaining. Yeah, the lag makes it a little hard to give advice. Yeah, and different people have different rules about how much advice they want. When I'm playing a game for the first time, I generally prefer to go into it, you know, as fresh as possible, not taking a lot of hints or anything from the chat. I mean, with this game, I don't really know how much advice you could offer me other than do the jumps better and don't get hit by ghosts, both of which I'm... Oh, yeah. I remember now. I think that's a different password than I had at the beginning the last time. Like, slightly different. But yeah, this has been Lizard. Thanks for watching. This was, a 3-hour stream? That's not bad. Might come back tomorrow for some more of this, or maybe some more Downwell, or one of the games I've been neglecting. Yeah, I had the Lizard of Knowledge, but I don't know what knowledge would have helped. I might give this another shot. I don't know. It's good in some ways and not good in others, but I'm glad it exists. I'm glad, you know, this is a labor of love, clearly, and I'm glad people are doing this stuff. Legacy of the Lizard, yeah. That's what they should call it. All right, well, have a good night, everyone, and I will talk to you soon. Goodbye.